no doubts, nothing like
relatively straightforward concepts.
Acha, so there is not much scope for. Okay, then it's good. I believe that you understood everything, so there are not many doubts. Yeah, okay, thankfully you are understanding things. Nice, that's what I want. Environment is an easy subject. It's not like, you know, that economy or something like that. They are a little difficult, not difficult, they are a little conceptually deeper. Yeah, Salient Features of Biodiversity Act, you must be aware. So to regulate access to biological resources of the country, means randomly anybody cannot just come and exploit the resource of the country. So yes, there should be some amount of checks and balances. So regulate access to biological resources, conserve the biodiversity and sustainably use biodiversity, respect and protect knowledge of local communities, respect and protect knowledge of local communities related to biodiversity, to secure sharing of benefits with local people as conservers of biological resources and holders of knowledge and information relating to the use of biological resources. You already know this, all these points. Conservation and development of areas of importance from the standpoint of biological diversity by declaring them as biodiversity heritage sites. One example I've already given, Aminpur Lake in Miapur. Protection and rehabilitation of threatened species. Then involvement of institutions of the state governments in the broad scheme of the implementation of Biodiversity Act through constitution of committees. And these are the agencies: national level, state level, local level. Not even a single point which you are unaware of. If you observe, we are just implementing those conventions as part of our national legislations. As part of our national legislations or as part of our national initiatives, we are implementing. Yes, ma'am? Clear? So, yes. National Biodiversity Authority shall be a body corporate having, okay, this is not necessary. The head office is located at Chennai. Then yes, biodiversity management committees. So what would this biodiversity management committees do? Just be aware of it. Promoting conservation. Okay. Promoting conservation. Then sustainable use and documentation of biodiversity, including preservation of habitats, conservation of land races. What is that land race? Folk varieties and cultivating varieties, domesticated stocks and breeds of animals and microorganisms. Land races, I know it must be a, what's it? No. Land races is not, don't take it literally, it's not land. Land races means there are certain species of both plants or animals which would be unique to this land. They may not be in the forest. They may not be in the forest, but that species are unique to this particular species of land. Yes, there are some plant species which you find only in Rayalaseema region. In the, especially in the community forest, in the village forest, or in the wastelands in the village, you will find such trees. They also have economic significance. They also have biodiversity value. You should not just neglect like that. One very good example I'll give, donkeys. You know, are we seeing donkeys these days? Where they have all gone? Huh? I'm sure in your childhood, some of you, not at least.
Replaced by trucks.
Replaced by trucks. So we have no utility now. But sure, soon we will be seeing donkeys only in, on paper or in, why? Because it's a land race actually, but we have not taken any significant measures to safeguard that. to safeguard that. If the same thing continues, maybe at a point of time, now most of the cities, they are getting rid of the minis of the stray dogs. Stray dogs, maybe in the, like if we lose the utility of the stray dogs, in the coming 3-5 decades, we may also lose the stray dogs. Just saying. Just we have get rid of donkey, we would also get rid of. So, such land races also, we have to preserve them. Such land races also, we cannot afford to lose those land races. We have to, yeah. Then likewise, folk varieties. Folk varieties means something which have been developed locally out of experience by people. Some folk variety of hybrid variety people would have, isn't it? Like just in our own state only, mangoes, how many varieties of mangoes we have? What are all this? These are all different varieties, different folk varieties which people have experimented, people would have developed. You cannot just afford to lose them like that. And cultivating varieties. Cultivars means cultivating varieties. So domesticated stocks and breeds. What is this domesticated stocks and breeds? Say Ongole, bull. Likewise, there are some varieties of sheep, some varieties of many things, poultry. They are domesticated stocks and breeds which are unique to that particular place. Which are unique to that particular place. That also, because of this menace of hybrid varieties, we are losing them. So those which are domesticated in this particular locality for a long time, such stocks and breeds of animals, we should safeguard them. We should safeguard them. And also microorganisms. Some microorganisms also have their own role to play. Curd in Maharashtra will taste different from curd in Telugu states, because the yeast used in preparation would be difficult, would be different there from the yeast which we are using it here. Wine which is tasted in vineyards of Nashik would be different from the wine which is tasted in the Europe, because each vineyard has its own distinctive climate. So different set of microorganisms would operate and would contribute that unique flavor or unique taste to that wine. Understood what I am trying to say? So even microorganisms are also important. Simple thing, for as your level, curd is a good example. Curd tastes different in different parts because different microorganisms, different yeast preparations. Yes, wine also tastes different at different places because different set of microorganisms have it. So biotechnology applications also we would be having. We should not ignore, or we should not afford to lose any of the native varieties. Got it? Yes. Then chronicling of knowledge relating to biodiversity. So all these activities will be performed by this biodiversity management committees. It can be a 10 marker. Biodiversity management committees can be a standalone 10 marker in your exam. You must be prepared. Yeah, land races means Nusividu mangoes is a good example. Folk varieties means native varieties, domesticated breeds. So all the above are biodiversity. These are our traditional wisdom. You cannot afford to lose them. What is traditional knowledge? We have been using that term several times. What if a separate 10 marker comes up in your exam?
Native knowledge. Ancient knowledge, like
Scientific? It's a scientific knowledge. What is scientific knowledge?
It has some approved experiments and experimental data.
We don't have any experiment. That's what we have discussed in the last class, right? Alternative medicinal systems. So what's the difference between alternative medicinal systems and mainstream medicine, Ma Vaishnavi?
They are not evidence based.
These are experiential based. Experiential based medicine versus experimental based medicine. Then what are the other criteria for us to be, to call something as scientific? Did I tell? Yeah, I remember I telling, me telling. Yeah, what are the other criteria for us to call something? Okay.
Peer review.
Okay.
Consistency.
Huh.
Repeatability.
Reproducibility. Then? That's it. end of thinking capacity. Shana?
Universal.
Yeah, universally reproducible or universally applicable, reproducible, verifiable, standard. Isn't it? Only when something is universally applicable, something which is standard, something which is reproducible, something which is verifiable, we call it as scientific knowledge. I told that reason why our alternative medicinal systems are lagging behind, they are not satisfying this criteria. So what we are supposed to do? Yeah, we have to invest in the research and development. We have to invest in the research and development, and we have to ensure that we also satisfy all these criteria so that we will elevate our stature of our alternative medicinal system to that of a mainstream medicinal systems. More number of clinical trials on conducting on the medical colleges, research and development centers, we have to establish, test the molecules, test their, you know, applicability universally, reproduce the results again and again, standardize the results, verify the results, test the results on different population. This is how we can make it more scientific and we can popularize it. Got it? That is what we have discussed, right, in the previous class. It's a distinction between alternative medicinal system and allopathic medicinal system or mainstream medicinal systems, right? Don't use the words like English medicine. You are not layman. Now, from this time, you must be content to use terms like allopathic medicinal system, mainstream medicinal system, alternative medicinal system. Yes. Keep observing. See, because I ensure that in my classes, I keep using lots of terms, terminologies are terms which are specific to exam context. So that is also one of the important thing you have to observe, not just from me, any faculty. While we are talking in class, we generally prefer not to talk in the layman language, because layman language is not expected from you. You have to write it in the context should be specific. The jargon should be specific. Doesn't mean that you have to bring in technical jargon, but suited to the context. That enhances the depth of your quality, and within less words you can express more. Yes. So traditional knowledge is the knowledge system possessed by various communities across the globe. Such knowledge has been accumulated over the years and has been used and passed down through several generations, usually with respect to the natural surroundings of the community, and includes agricultural knowledge such as manner of cultivation, environmental knowledge, and knowledge of natural medicines. All these things are various components of traditional medicines. And one initiative taken by Government of India in the recent times is this Traditional Knowledge Digital Library. You heard about it? TKDL. What is that? What it does? Documents. What else? It documents the traditional knowledge. The struggle that India has to undergo to nullify the patent granted to turmeric brought to the forefront the dismal state of documentation of Indian traditional knowledge. Had there been prior proper documentation, turmeric would not have been granted a patent in the first place. However, better late than never, the Indian government realized the necessity for the documentation of the valuable traditional knowledge of the country, and in pursuance of this created the Traditional Knowledge Digital Library, an integrated global biopiracy watch system. What is this? It's an integrated global biopiracy watch system that allows for the monitoring of a patent application that seeks to patent Indian medical systems. It serves as a prior art registry and as a defensive mechanism against biopiracy. It's understood. Everything is already discussed. Nothing new here. So the TKDL is a joint effort of CSIR and the Department of Ayurveda, Department of Ayush. It enables effective detection of attempts of misappropriation of the knowledge by third parties filing applications with patent offices around the world. Okay. Then there is one more legislation. This has the potential to protect biodiversity, especially agriculture biodiversity. That is this Plant Variety Protection and Farmers' Rights Act. Plant Variety Protection and Farmers' Rights Act. So what is this? It's an attempt by the Indian government to recognize and protect the rights of both commercial plant breeders and farmers in respect of their contribution made in conserving, improving, and making available plant genetic resources for development of new plant varieties, and to encourage the development of new plant varieties. Say, native knowledge of development of agricultural varieties should be conserved. Somebody else should not randomly come and try to steal this knowledge. That's the intent of this legislation. It's not that legislations will be asked as a questions, but you should know these points. This will act as a fodder points when you are writing answers for other questions. Clear? Sure. Yeah, just read this. This slide actually, I'll do something, I'll discuss about this slide again when I'm talking about international organization. But now quickly see this. So what this slide is, various initiatives being taken worldwide for protection of biodiversity. Various initiatives being taken worldwide for protection of biodiversity. Just observe carefully. Yeah. So only a small percent of the total land area within biodiversity hotspots is now protected. Though it is labeled as a biodiversity hotspot, but still it is not accorded protection by national governments. See, calling something as a biodiversity hotspot will happen at the international level. But actually, international community cannot come and sit here and protect. It's the responsibility of the national government, state governments, and local government to protect. It has been declared as a biodiversity hotspot. But they should have that sense of protecting this biodiversity hotspot. They means national government, state governments, local governments. So yes, several international organizations are working in many ways to conserve biodiversity hotspots. One, Critical Ecosystem Partnership Fund. UPSC has asked a question on it in prelims once. Critical Ecosystem Partnership Fund. The name itself is suggestive. Critical Ecosystem Partnership Fund. It's a funding mechanism. The name itself is suggestive. It's a funding mechanism. It's a global program that provides funding and technical assistance to NGOs to protect biodiversity. Okay? The name itself is suggestive. Critical Ecosystems Partnership Fund. What it will do? Provide assistance. What type of assistance? Financial assistance. And technical assistance to whom? NGOs and other agencies which are involved in the process of biodiversity conservation. As simple as that. Then World Wildlife Fund for Nature, WWF. It's a very important organization. World Wide Fund for Nature, WWF. Don't think that WWF. It's World Wide Fund for Nature. So they have something called as, they have a program called as Global 200 Ecoregions. It's a very important program. Global 200 ecoregions. So who launched this program? Global 200 ecoregions. It's, yes, WWF. Global 200. Atma? Worldwide. Worldwide Fund for Nature. So the aim of which is to select priority ecoregions for conservation. For conservation. Okay. So they are chosen for their species richness, endemism, taxonomic uniqueness, unusual ecological or evolutionary phenomenon, global rarity. These are the criteria based on which they will select this 200 ecoregions. All these points I've already discussed. If you remember, what is an area which has unusual ecological or evolutionary phenomenon? Any example I've given? I told, right? Unusual means these are the kind of ecologies which are not found anywhere else but are only unique here. Isn't it? Remember that you're saying something? That meteorite lake, all these are different examples. You will not find these kind of ecosystem anywhere else other than our region. So likewise, based on certain criteria, they would identify 200 very important ecoregions and they'll try to protect those ecoregions. As simple as that. Then we have another very important program, BirdLife International. BirdLife International. So what does BirdLife International do? It will identify endemic bird areas, each of which hold important species. So BirdLife International has identified around how many IBAs? Around 11,000 IBAs and EBAs it has identified. Means certain areas where you find unique species of birds. You find unique species of birds and couple of birds must be endemic to that places. They are called as endemic bird areas. Endemic bird areas. in the important bird areas. Important bird areas. There is a slight distinction between them, but there is overlap between EBAs and IBAs. EBAs enjoy more protection because they have endemic birds. Important birds means significant or important birds. So that is about this Bird Life International initiative, endemic bird areas and important bird areas. The reason why I am not going into detail, because these are the things which fall in the domain of current affairs, but I thought I'll just introduce you to these kind of topics so you know how to read your current affairs. Then Plant Life International does the same work Bird Life International do for birds. Then Alliance for Zero Extinction, it's an initiative of many scientific organizations and conservation groups who cooperate to focus on most threatened endemic species of the world. They have identified these many sites and bird life important and bird areas. So it's another initiative, Alliance for Zero Extinction. The National Geographic Society has prepared a world map of the hotspots and ArcView shapefile and metadata for the biodiversity hotspot, including details of the individual endangered fauna in each hotspot, available from Conservation International. There is one more important agency, Conservation International. And National Geographic Society has prepared a mapping of all the vulnerable regions. So all these things, Government of India also has established something called as CAMPA, Compensatory Afforestation Fund Management and Planning Authority, about which I'll discuss when I'm talking about the topic of compensatory afforestation. I'll mention about this CAMPA authority. So it is meant to, what is this CAMPA? Function of CAMPA is to spend effectively the funds which are getting collected into compensatory afforestation fund. We have something called as compensatory afforestation fund. I'll tell you why the compensatory afforestation fund has been created and how much of fund is available and how we are planning to spend that CAMPA fund is an important idea for us. Okay, so these are some of the initiatives: Critical Ecosystem Partnership Fund, Worldwide Fund for Nature, Bird Life International, Plant Life International, Alliance for Zero Extinction, then Conservation International and its initiative of National Geographic Society for mapping of the world hotspots. Everything here is factual. Not even a single content which we have discussed now is analytical or conceptual. Okay, it's all about facts. Read them once again, you will just get an idea. Man-animal conflict. Did we discuss? Complete. Acha. We'll discuss now in a little bit more detail. Concept of man-animal conflict. So what this image? It's a classical picture in Indian village, especially in Andhra Pradesh, Chittoor district, Karnataka also. Man-animal conflict, yeah. So it's a very common phenomenon these days because we are encroaching into their territories. It's bound to generate conflict. Isn't it? So elephants raiding agricultural lands. So that is about this concept of man-animal conflict. A good illustration. Why do man-animal conflict occur? Simple. So let's imagine this is the territory. Animal territory. Let's call it forest. Now, what all we are doing in the forest? We want tourism resorts in the forest. Some people encroach. Some places they are permitted. Some people encroach. Then we are resorting to hunting zone, hunting and poaching. Direct conflict. Agriculture, some people also occupy forest areas and do agriculture. It's also very common in India. We resort to habitat fragmentation. Then also there is a scope for coming in conflict with animals. Then we introduce invasive species. Remember that example? Yeah, Bhagavati, what is that example of Pavitra Wildlife Sanctuary? We discussed in the class. You are not aware. Yeah, Vishnu.
Non-edible grass is growing mostly in Pavitra National Park, which is leading to dinosaurs attacking
humans.
So we have to decrease that non-edible grass and we have to increase the
cutting of edible grass. Clear? Everybody understood? So you understood the link between invasive species and how it can contribute to man-animal conflict. Forest fires? Yes, because of forest fires also, we are animals out of fear, they'll try to come out of their territories and then they'll start attacking animals or humans. So all these are the human activities because of our activities. So animals leave their natural habitats. So when they leave their natural habitats, they'll come to our habitats, and that has become the source of man-animal conflict. Simple idea, nothing difficult. You can see here, right? This elephant, electric fence, it got electrocuted and it got killed. Yes, and this slide shows us. So how to address this problem of man-animal conflict? Yeah, tell me. How can we address the problem of man-animal? Okay, good. One good measure. First of all, let's have buffer zones. If we have buffer zones, we can minimize the pressure on the forest ecosystems. What else we can do? Reserve forest areas. What, ma?
Reserve forest areas.
Reserve forest means protected forest.
Yeah, people are not allowed to enter inside the forest.
National parks, right? National parks. National park, they'll allow people for tourism. Yes. Yeah, only tourism is permitted.
There is a concept of reserve forests. Is it? Like, there are developed forests
where
people are not allowed inside, and they will develop species inside.
Achha, actually, as far as I know, in India, we have only four types. Ma. One is national parks, other is sanctuaries, community reserves, conservation reserves. That's it. Some types of forests are there, reserved forests, but I don't think reserved forests are exclusive. Anyways, we will discuss that topic in detail. We have that separate, I'll show the slides also, we'll discuss about it. Okay? Yes. But wildlife corridors we can create, buffer zones we can create. What else we can do?
Sustainable.
Sustainable?
Like in the recent Assam
project,
there is the embankments of river because of which there was huge floods in the park. Because of which the animals mitigated from the parks to the local habitats.
People are living, there was an animal conflict. So using fines on people if they hurt the animal or if they try to hurt the animal.
First of all, why should we go to animals?
Animals
come to us. Of course, when animals come to you, you have to do something, right? You can't
because
welcome
people,
it.
People are killing the wild animals especially. So, to prevent that,
poaching, you mean to say that you have to prevent illegal poaching hunting? Yes, ma'am. Agreed. You are saying something, Ma Vaishnavi.
Providing food in forest itself for animals so that they will not come out for food, search of food.
Okay. You cannot provide food as such. You safeguard the forest. That will automatically take care of their food. We can't feed our people only. How can we feed all the animals? So, we safeguard the forest, ma'am. We should safeguard the forest. Nature itself will take care. It's not practical for us to give food. Water we can give. We are giving also.
Tigers, we are providing food in the forest so that
they
will not come out.
Is it? I'm not aware. Are they doing it, ma? Somewhere, any initiative? Achha, even I have not heard. Maybe they are doing. Some places where there is gross shortage of food, what they tend to do is that they try to connect two corridors so that tigers can move into that other corridor where there is adequate prey. That I know, but provision of food directly, I heard about this vulture restaurant concept. For vultures, because we hardly have only hundreds of in numbers. Vulture, na, you must be aware because of this diclofenac, not DDT. Yeah, because of usage of this painkiller called as diclofenac in veterinary practice.
The animals which die in the villages or houses, which are not vaccinated by the diclofenac.
No, diclofenac is not a vaccine, ma. Diclofenac is a painkiller.
It will be given to the animals.
Yes, ma. As a painkiller. Usually, na, for animals, diclofenac, these veterinarians, they'll inject. They use it indiscriminately. So, what will happen? This diclofenac will get deposited in the tissues of the animals. And when these animals die, often the carcasses, they won't cremate, they'll just leave it open like that. whenever these vultures feed on this carcasses, no? Whenever these vultures feed on this carcasses, they are very sensitive to this diclofenac. It causes renal failures in the vultures, and we have lost lakhs of vultures, and now we have only numbers in hundreds. Vultures, which used to be very, very much seen all over the countryside, but nowadays we rarely see vultures. Rarely see vultures. Eagles and all we can see, falcons, eagles we can see, but vultures these days we are not at all seeing. Their numbers are getting extinct. So that's the reason some places they have arranged vulture restaurants. Vulture restaurant means not restaurants for us. The vultures will be fed with meat, uncontaminated wheat, which is not contaminated with diclofenac. But water also we are providing in some of the, especially the South Indian forests, because of drought like conditions in the forest, animals forage into villages in search of water. So what we are doing, a forest department in the water holes, sometimes they are to filling, they are taking tankers and filling the water, or they have arranged water ponds, and in the water ponds they will be filling water, especially during hot summer season. They would know, they would locate these places, and they will not face water crisis. Is there any link between Parsi communities and Parsi communities are supporting, you know why? Yeah, what do we call that? Tower of Silence. Here also we have, right? Parsi Gutta. That Ramnagar, in Ramnagar we have that Parsi Gutta. That's actually a Tower of Silence. Means wherein they won't cremate their dead bodies. So vultures will come and eat. Now vultures are not there. They are facing, it's a culture, right? It's part of their culture. Cremating something, cremating their near and dear is something very emotional aspect for them. But because of human activity, we are losing vultures. Yes. Yeah, one way of biofencing.
The kind of crops we also grow determine the entry of animals into the field. Suppose you have chili, then animals don't come into the field.
But just for the sake of animals, we can't grow chili everywhere. Right? Yeah. You can do this biofencing. Biofencing with thorny plants we can do. Sometimes trenches can be dug, all these things can, in few cases embankments, fencing. But when you do electric fencing, you know, you end up doing that, so you can resort to biofencing, digging of pits, solar powered fences with minimal electricity. Likewise, we can take certain initiatives to prevent attacks by animals.
Most often we only see elephants.
Why? Everything, like monkeys are such a big menace, you know, especially in places like Uttarakhand and all the forest villages. You have this thing in your, you know, like, we'll also study it as part of it. Schedule 6. Some animals, we call them. Schedule 5. Some animals, we call them. Vermins. No, there are state government's discretion. Say in some states, nilgais, globules we call them, nilgais are declared as vermins. They are a type of deer. Some states, rhesus monkey, wild boars. In our state, especially in Rayalaseema region, proximity to Lankamalla sanctuary, in the Palakondalu region, we have wild boar attacks. These wild boars, they come, they destroy forests, they eat, and not forests, they destroy agricultural crops and they go back to forests. It's a big menace. Monkey menace also these days from forests, as they are not having much food in the forest. So they come to, you know, agricultural crops, they destroy animal crops and go back. All these are called as vermins. Vermins means they have the potential to cause loss of livelihood to people. Such things, they will be declared as vermins. I'll discuss about it. We are discussing, while discussing Wildlife Protection Act, I'll mention about those vermins. Clear, ma?
Yes.
So all these things we can do. Tiger corridors, like simply put, wildlife animal corridors. Wildlife corridors can help us prevent, from the man-animal conflict. Can you see this? It's a good slide actually. I want to show you. tiger corridors. What the hell? Okay, it's now detecting.
Actually, it's not.
Okay. So here, if you can see, this is Pench Tiger Reserve. This is Kanha Tiger Reserve. So this is a tiger corridor connecting two. So this is Satpura Tiger Reserve, Pench Tiger Reserve, connecting two. This is Tadoba, Navigav, connecting both. So like this, we can have tiger corridors. These are nothing but wildlife corridors. They can address man-animal conflict. This slide actually, the PDF I shared, it's properly visible. Here it's not visible. It gives a statistical analysis how different places are getting affected because of man-animal conflict. Say how livestock loss, crop loss, we are having, all these things are depicted here. It's just to enrich your understanding of the concept. Okay. What is this? Community forest management or joint forest management. You heard about this term. This also can, to some extent, address the problem of. It has been talked about as part of 1988 forest policy. Community forest management. Involving members of the community in management of the forest. Presently in India, the style of management of the forest is largely controlled by forest officials, forest bureaucrats. And we have systematically isolated people from the forest. Previously, people used to have access to forest. People are part of the forest. They used to live happily and harmoniously with nature. Britishers have come. So they have a lot of demand for timber. So with this demand for timber, they told tribals, they have driven away tribals from the forest. They have passed many laws, which we also have continued in the independence, post-independence time. We did not bother to repeal those laws, or we did not bother to make laws which actually protects our tribals. Tribals used to be the protectors of the Indian forest. But rather than treating them as the protectors of the forest, we have driven them away from the forest, labeling certain areas as protected areas. In reality, though they are labeled as protected areas, now government has all the monopoly of these areas. All the forest officials or the forest bureaucrats enjoy a sway over vast tracts of this forest. So whenever they are in collusion with the local politicians or they are in collusion with the organized criminals, so this has encouraged destruction of forests in Indian context. And this also has isolated people. So people also have lost incentive in protection of the forest. Locals previously, they themselves used to safeguard the forest. Now they are not interested in safeguarding the forest, because why would they be interested in something which they don't even have access to? They would be penalized if they enter into forest. They don't have any rights over the forest. Even their pre-existing rights of the forest have been nullified, de-recognized. So these people, locals themselves, they have turned criminals and they started poaching, they started illegal logging, they started encroaching into the forest and stealing of the minor forest produce, something which previously they used to enjoy as their right, as a matter of right. In the post-independent phase, we have disempowered them. This has many consequences. They lost their livelihood, ma. We call it forest-based livelihoods. It's a very important term. Forest-based livelihoods. So their livelihoods are based on forests. For people in the rural areas, what is the resource? Agriculture land is the resource. But for people who are in the fringes of the forest, who are in the forest, what is their livelihood base? It's forest. So their livelihoods are forest-based livelihoods. So the forest-based livelihoods are gone at one go when you say you are not even allowed to enter into the forest. Like this, lakhs of people, they lost their livelihood. Say craft, bamboo craft making. In my childhood, like when the laws were not so severely implemented, we used to have lots of bamboo in all houses, bamboo thatched roofs, bamboo chairs or cane furniture. All those things, they used to be not expensive. They used to be less expensive. They are widely available and lakhs of people are employed in that. They used to get some business activity likewise. And they are also biodegradable. They are also environmental friendly objects. But we made laws and we deprived them access to forests. So they are losing their forest based livelihoods. Something as simple as, what is that? We apply for shikakai. Kunkudukai shikakai. It's like, it used to be, it's not at all an expensive one. Now they have become very expensive. It used to be available at less price in those days, but now they're all become very expensive, isn't it? There is one shop recently, like I have to go to it, not because I have to purchase, Forest Essential something. It's in GVK Mall. Everything there, nothing there is less than 2000 rupees, 2500, and they are calling it Advanced Ayurveda. Advanced Ayurveda, Ayurveda is something we expect at less price or cheaper prices. They have named it as Ayurveda, but it is Advanced Ayurveda, and they are literally extorting money from people. Anyways, so coming to this, why people have lost motivation to protect forests? Because their rights are derecognized. Their rights are derecognized. They are not even allowed to enter into forests. They have lost their forest-based livelihood. Then what they would resort to? They lost their livelihood. They are not properly educated. They are not properly skilled. We have not shown them alternative income source. So what they'll do, they will try to, that's next level. They'll try to find alternative means to enter into forests. They'll try to exploit the forest resources under the carpet. So something which should happen in a legal manner has become illegal. So encroaching upon the forest, illegal logging, illegal exploitation of the minor forest produce, and illegal mining, all these led to destruction of the forest. So at a point of time, we have realized that it's not possible for us to conserve forest, protect forest, promote forest without involving people. So only through community forest management or only through joint forest management, it will be possible for us to administer our forest areas in a more effective manner. If we have to administer our forest areas, we have to take on board people, local community. We have to believe them. We have to instill confidence in them that yes, they, in collaboration with the forest department, in a democratic way, they will try to protect the forest. There is one very popular Namibia model. Namibia model. You know what this Namibia model? There are also demands for, you know, implementation of this Namibia model of conservation in India also. In Namibia model, you know, locals are empowered to even hunt animals. They'll be given a target. Target means, say, for this ecosystem, we can tell that how many tigers are there, so the ecosystem will be healthy. We can tell. Say, for if 100 tigers are there, this ecosystem will be healthy. But if the numbers cross 100, say 150, so that extra 50 will be allowed to hunt. So what now? People will have an incentive, right, to not kill animal. You don't kill animals, so you increase their numbers, then you can kill those animals, then you can hunt those animals. Now, because their increase in number will be detrimental to the ecosystem itself. So that's called as Namibia model. Of course, it's not simple to implement in Indian context. We are a huge country, but simply put, I am trying forest management, where you have community members along with forest department. It has several benefits. It will make forest management more democratic. It can revive forest-based livelihoods. It can revive forest-based livelihoods, and it will ensure that forest conservation or forest protection or forest management happens in a more rigorous manner. In a more rigorous manner. Understood, ma? Very, very important concept. And this concept has attained maturity by 2006, scheduled tribes and other forest dwellers, protection of Forest Rights Act. It's a powerful piece of legislation which has been passed in the year 2006, which recognize scheduled tribes and other forest dwellers, scheduled tribes and other forest dwellers, protection of Forest Rights Acts, protection of Forest Rights Acts, which means it recognizes individuals' rights over forests, community rights over forest resources, individuals' rights over forest lands, certain pieces of forest lands, and community rights over certain pieces of forest lands. It's a powerful piece of legislation. UPA government was widely hailed for this legislation, along with NAREGA Act, along with right to education, right to information. People say that this is one game changer legislation which has come to India, which has empowered the tribals. Empowered the tribals, recognizing the legal rights of the tribals and other forest dwellers over the forest regions, over the forest region. So that is about the scheduled tribes and other forest dwellers, protection of Forest Rights Act. For your mains examination, what is important is the way in which the act is implemented, challenges in the implementation of the act, then better implementation of the act. Write down a question, you will understand the importance of it. Discuss in detail salient features of scheduled tribes and other forest dwellers, scheduled tribes and other forest dwellers, protection of Forest Rights Act, scheduled tribes and other forest dwellers, protection of Forest Rights Act. Add a note on various challenges. Add a note on various challenges in its implementation. Suggest a way forward. Take this as an assignment for your next class. Read from internet sources, read some good articles, try to write a good answer for this. Read the question, everybody understood. Tell me if there is anything difficult to understand in the question. Understood the question, ma?
So, scheduled tribes also include communities, right? Other than scheduled tribes?
Yes. Other forest dwellers also, other forest. But you can focus more on scheduled tribes because most of the content available internet, it will be on scheduled tribes. Everybody understood, ma? Question? All of you clear, ma? That is about this joint forest management, community forest management. Are you clear about this idea? What is joint forest management? Why we need joint forest management, or why we need community forest management? Yes. So community members can sustainably use resource of the forest, protect the forest. Minor forest produce like honey, gum, lac, soap nut, areca leaves. Now, so I think, should I start discussing? Yeah, we can start. We have 15 minutes more. Concept of indicator species. Indicator species. So what are these indicator species? They will indicate the quality of ecosystem. Means their presence or their absence will indicate the quality of the ecosystem. So what did I say? Their presence or their absence will indicate the quality of the ecosystem. Tell one day-to-day example which you have observed.
Yeah,
dolphins. You don't see daily, right?
Sparrows.
Earthworms.
Good. Sparrows. Earthworms. Okay. Yeah. butterflies, very good. Butterflies.
Water hyacinth.
Water hyacinth, good. Yes. Yes, yes. Water hyacinth. What, ma'am? Caterpillar is not a species as such, right? Caterpillar is a stage of development in a particular species. It's not any species of organism. What, ma? Bees. Bee. Honey bee, whatever bees. So what bees indicate or bees indicate? Bees are good for ecosystem. So if you find bees, the ecosystem is healthy or not healthy? Bees, if you find bees, ecosystem is healthy. If you find butterflies, ecosystem is healthy.
Pollination is...
Yeah, pollination will happen if you have bees. Frogs. If you have frogs, your soil is less polluted. I told this example, remember? Say, in cities, even if it rains, we rarely find frogs. But in village areas, after a small rain also, you will find frogs, isn't it? And in the water puddles also, you will see small tadpole larvae of the frogs. Cities, you find that? You don't find nothing. Soil is so much polluted, water is so much polluted, water will be just like water. There won't be any frogs. It's because the ecosystem is healthy there. Soil ecosystem is healthy, water is less polluted. So immediately after rainfall, you will find all these things. Yes. And in rural areas, after rainfall, there will be that distinctive smell of the
soil.
In Hyderabad, no such smells you can appreciate. Maybe your locality is relatively. But most often we don't find it. In villages, you will definitely that earthen smell. It's because of some microorganisms. Certain microbial reaction which will happen, it will give that earthen flavor or aroma, whatever you want to call it, to the after rainfall. But such things we don't have because soils are contaminated. Coming to the idea of, I think by this time you should be clear about what is an indicator species. These species indicate the health of the ecosystem. Their presence indicate the health of the ecosystem, or their absence indicate the health of the ecosystem, right? Yes. So you can see it here, certain species of, if you find this stonefly, if you find this stonefly, which means water is healthy. You see in fresh lakes sometimes, you will find one type of stonefly on the surface. If that is there, which means water is very healthy. On the other hand, if you have this tubifex worms, you will find them in Musi a lot. So the tubifex worms, they are present means that, yes, you won't find stonefly in a polluted water. They can't survive. Likewise, other good example is this lichens. Lichens. You saw this? Lichens. Especially when you have visited any hill stations. On the rock surface. Even on the walls also, you will see that green color, right? You can also, like near my office also, that Boinpalli region, cantonment, it's relatively less polluted, right? During rainy season, we will have that green growths on the walls. Yeah, we call that lichens. Or different species of mosses, they are called. If they are present, means air is less polluted. Air is less polluted. If any, they cannot withstand any amount of air pollution. Especially the sulfur dioxide in the air, they cannot withstand. Sulfur dioxide will be more where vehicular pollution is more. So, any pollution they can't withstand, they'll die off. Yes. If there is no black spot fungus on a rose, black spot fungus, lot of sulfur dioxide is in air. On roses also, we will see some black fungus, black spot fungus. If it is not there, which means there is sulfur dioxide in the air. You understand about this lichens? I'm sure all of you would have seen, especially when you visit any hill stations or the coastal regions also sometimes, you will find this greenish thing everywhere. Can give us information about the quality of the soil, a frog, isn't it? Earthworm. Earthworms also, if a soil is less contaminated, less polluted, you will find earthworms. Otherwise, you won't. Grizzly bears. Grizzly bears, these are a type of bears. So, if the healthy bear population tells us fish are thriving, forests are healthy, and the ecosystem is balanced. Healthy BR population tell us fish are thriving because what they eat on fish. So fish, if you want to have fish, you want to have water. Is it? So recently what happened? One species called as otters. Otter species numbers have increased in the Krishna mangroves, Krishna region, Machilipatnam. Farmers have started noticing this otters. What it indicates? Actually, it indicates the good health of the ecosystem. Because otters will feed on fish in fresh water. Fish in fresh water will survive only if the water is fresh. Only if you have abundant fish, this otter species will survive. So if you see otter species, that itself is an indicator that okay, this ecosystem is well maintained. This ecosystem has adequate amount of fish. Like that, certain species we can use them as an indicator species to indicate the health of the ecosystems. Then there is one more simple concept called as keystone species. What are these keystone species? Have you ever seen an arch? Yeah, there will be one stone called as, or couple of stones sometimes. These are called as keystones or keystone. You remove this keystone, what will happen? Yeah, the structural stability of this will get disrupted. Sometimes it may even collapse also. Such important is this keystone for the structural integrity of that so-called building or so-called structure. Got it? Just like that, there are some species which are called as keystone species. Means you take them away from the ecosystem, ecosystem may collapse, or it severely disturbs the balance of the ecosystem. Such species are called as keystone species. A keystone species is a plant or animal that plays a unique and crucial role in the way an ecosystem functions. Without keystone species, the ecosystem would be dramatically different or cease to exist altogether. Look, this image, very interesting. You have shark here. Shark is a keystone species. Say, now I removed shark. Means we have hunted out, we humans, and we removed shark. So what happened to this intermediate species? Actually, it's Comos race. Their number, what happened? 2 to 4. So what they have done to this primary race, primary level species, they have eaten up all this. Their numbers have declined. You have removed this. These numbers have increased. These numbers have declined. At a point of time, this also will go. When this will go, this will not have anything to eat. Entire ecosystem will go collapsed. Such species are called as keystone species. I already gave this example once, if you remember.
Yes.
By giving example of tiger. I gave example of tiger, isn't it?
So, can we call all apex predators?
I am coming to that. Yeah, that's a good question. I'll come. Yeah, you can see it here. In this previous lecture continuation, shark population had its impact on population of other species in food chain like Camos rays, bivalve arthropods, which are the primary at the beginning stage of the trophic level. Here, sea otters are the keystone species. If sea otters are removed, say what will happen? The sea otters keeps animals such as urchins, abalones, mussels that eat the kelp forest in check. Even though sea otters have predators, the health of the ecosystem depends on them. So in this case, sea otter is not an apex predator. Apex predator is still shark only, but sea otters will maintain the balance of the ecosystem by sea otters eating upon these mussels, abalones and orchids. But sea otters have commercial value, so people tend to exploit sea otters. And if the numbers of the sea otters decline, what will happen? Mussels, abalones, orchids will increase. They'll eat away the kelp forest. We call it seaweeds, kelps. In the present year budget also, they have mentioned about seaweed farming. Government of India mentioned about seaweed farming. Seaweed farming is nothing but kelp forests, kelp cultivation. So yes, you would have seen by this time, you would have understood what a keystone species. You remove the keystone species, you are, yes, spoiling the integrity of the ecosystem. Likewise, beavers, you already seen it, right? Ecosystem engineers. Beavers build dams and create ponds where other organisms live. You remove beavers, then this ecosystem may not even form and ecosystem will not be maintained. American alligators digs holes that hold fresh water during dry spells and serve as refuges for aquatic life and provide fresh water. Likewise, each of them has its own role in maintaining the ecosystem. So I think, Nihar, is it clear now? It need not always be apex predators. Sometimes it will be apex predators. Many times it will be apex predators. Sometimes it may not be apex predators. Yes, one last point to add before I end this session. Today I'll stop the session by 12:30. As I've told that, yes, there is a possibility that apex predators will be keystone species. Sometimes other species which are in different place at a different position in the food chain or apex are keystone species. But it is also possible that in an ecosystem, it's difficult for us to identify sometimes which exactly is the keystone species. See, not every time we can tell confidently that something or other is the keystone species. Sometimes our knowledge would not be sufficient to specifically identify certain species as a keystone species. Then in such case, what we should do? Yeah, we should remain calm and we should not touch with any aspect of the ecosystem. Means it's called as a landscape approach. Landscape approach means you protect the entire ecosystem. Don't protect a tiger, don't protect elephant like that. Means you should not be obsessed only with one animal or other animal like that. Protect the entire ecosystem. Protect the entire habitat that will take care of all the animals. Okay. One more assignment for you, read about landscape approach. Landscape approach. You write very well. I forget asking in the next class assignments. You also conveniently ignore to tell me the assignments given in the previous class. Let me assign somebody for this purpose. Nidhi, from next session, you should tell me what are the assignments given in the previous session. You should do it first and ensure that others do so that we will begin the classes with the assignments, ma. Okay. So, what are the assignments for today's session? One. Landscape approach. Right. One more. Read about. What, ma?
GM crops.
What? Read about genes. It will be important for your SNT. Read about one more thing. Parivesh portal. What is this Parivesh portal? P-A-R-I-V-E-S-H. What is this Parivesh portal? Read about it. Okay, I'll stop my class for you. Thanks. Meanwhile, keep reading that PDF.